our regular Tuesday show, Frags of Beer Radio Live. We're going to, as usual, cover news from the past week. I'm joined today by Jasyn. I'm joined today by Jasyn Jones, also known as Daddy Warpig, to some of you who follow us on Twitter and Facebook. Thanks for joining us, Jasyn.
Thanks for having me on.
And as usual, we're joined by one of our writers, Russell, who's going to cover some stuff for us. But I wanted to recap. Welcome, Russell again. I wanted to recap. Last week, we talked about the UN's ultimatum to Japan about banning the sale of manga and video games that depicted sexual violence or violence against women. And we have recently found, run on Niche Gamer and a couple other sites, but Japan sent a response. And you can read the response on Niche Gamer in its entirety, but there's a couple points that I wanted to pull out of it because I think they're very valid points. And so we're going to recap this story a little bit. Basically, the UN sent this ultimatum to Japan and said to, you know, to help with women's rights and women's issues, that Japan needed to ban the sale of anime, manga, and video games that depicted violence against women. And we talked about it in the respect of some of these games. It's such a broad definition that they gave, and such a broad, I mean, you could almost catch anything in that net of censorship. And that's kind of that's one of the huge problems with something like that, is when you make definitions so broad, it allows regulators and legislators to pretty much do whatever they want. But Japan responded, and they pretty much, TLDR, they said, no, not going to happen. But the main point that they made, two main points that they made, is these are fictional characters in manga and video games. They're not real people. And they said specifically that if the UN is so concerned about women's rights, they need to stop focusing on make-believe fictional characters and focus on the real women in the world who are being beaten and hurt and abused and oppressed in countries all over the world where it's actually happening. And the second point they made, which I think is even more valid and translates even better to the states and Western countries, is there are a lot of women who have come up in Japanese art, in manga especially. They said they didn't have jobs. Specifically, they say before the Equal Opportunity Act for Men and Women in 86, there were already a lot of women who were very successful in manga and making a good living and a good career in this. And if they were to start banning the sale of manga especially, they would damage the very people, the real people that the UN claims to want to help. The women who are working in these fields and creating this art and creating these games would suddenly be without jobs because all of the sudden they're banning the sale of this stuff. So I think that's a very good point, because over here we see a lot of people talk about censorship of games, or these kind of games aren't acceptable, but these kind of games need to be kind of ignored, or reviews need to be written to make these kind of games go away. And there are women that work on the staff and the development teams of these game companies that you would be hurting by doing that. And I think that's something people forget when these ideologues stand up and say things like ban these games or ban this manga.
Yeah, that latter argument is really good from a shutting up people who want to ban them context. It's like you're all concerned about women. You'll hurt women if you ban these games,
right?
Or these mediums. That's a great argument that turns it around on themselves.
I thought it was. I thought it was. It definitely makes you think about it. And Jasyn, did you see? I mean, does that come in? You had some more when we talked before the show, but does that kind of, I guess, make sense to you too? What they responded with?
Well, the United Nations really has no room to comment on issues like this. United Nations soldiers in conflicts around the globe have engaged in sexual slavery with children as young as...
So to get back into it, like I said, we were going to talk about Iron Fist casting, and they said, being the Marvel guy, I know Iron. When I saw a lot of the outrage, first of all, I didn't care one way or the other. When they talked about who was announced or who was being talked to, I didn't care. They were talking to Asian actors and white actors. I could really care less.
I didn't care, honestly, because honestly, all I want out of it is a good actor. I don't care otherwise.
Right.
Or at least one, and especially hopefully one that knows martial arts so that they don't have to use like very obvious stunt actors to play for those parts. Which I guarantee you Charlie Cox had a ton of them in those Daredevil scenes.
Yeah, and to me, it like I said, initially it didn't matter. And when they announced who it was, I'm like, okay, you know, so what? But then people started getting pissed. And what I saw and what I found funny about it, I saw a lot of people that seemed to not know. It's almost like a lot of people that were initially outraged thought Iron Fist in the comics was Asian. And then when people pointed out that he was white, then they acted like, oh, well, I knew that, but it's still wrong. They should have cast an Asian guy to play him.
Well, I think the casting is kind of problematic.
Why? Who do you think it should have been?
Well, here's the problem is, you know that Iron Fist is a white American superhero. Right. And yet, once again, over and over again, by the way, I'm stealing this from Dorkly just to give proper credit.
No, go ahead.
We are casting a British actor to play an American superhero. We have, again and again and again, this happens. We have Henry Cavill playing Superman. We have Welshman Christian Bale playing Batman. Londoner Tom Harding playing Spider-Man. Who, by the way, the previous Spider-Man was another British person, Andrew Garfield, and in the same universe on Netflix, Charlie Cox playing Daredevil. So many times. We are taking roles of Americans and just giving them away to British. We are having the British invade our country and appropriate our culture, and it's time
the Beatles
something
all over
was done
again.
About it.
Yeah.
The Beatles all over again.
You know, that's a very good way to carry the same point as ludicrously as, and I'm hoping you're being 100% facetious with this, but yeah, it is quite ludicrous. And when I saw it, like I, for instance, when you do Google Iron Fist casting, the first thing that comes up is an NME article, where a Marvel writer, I think she's a writer, Marjorie Liu responded, said Iron Fist is an orientalist white man yellow fever narrative. Asian actor would have helped subvert that offensive trope and reclaim space. Now, this is clearly a person who works for Marvel that doesn't know shit about Marvel.
Yeah, of course.
He was not created as the yellow fever narrative from the 70s. He was created when martial arts movies were popular, and Marvel already had a character at the time, which I'm trying to remember his name, and now I forget.
Was Iron Fist created before or after that David Carradine show Kung Fu?
It was actually inspired by the show. Let's see. Let me make sure I'm reading this right, because the creator.
The David Carradine show Kung Fu is about a white guy learning martial arts in
right.
Asia.
And well, actually, the writer says he'd seen his first Kung Fu movie, and even before the Bruce Lee one came out, it had a thing called The Ceremony of the Iron Fist in it, and I thought it was a good name. So he was inspired by an old Kung Fu movie he'd seen. Now, Marvel already had, let me find, Shang-Chi. So they already had Shang-Chi, who was the master of Kung Fu. So they already had an Asian character who was the master of Kung Fu, and they wanted another character to play off of this. So they created not an Asian fever character, but they created the Strange Man in a Strange Land character, which is it has been a valid story plot device or whatever you want to call it. It's been valid forever. They've been using it was used in all kinds of ancient, whether it be Asians in Europe or Europeans in Asia or
the
Europeans
Odyssey, Journey to the West, all of that stuff.
So to see a Marvel writer say something like that, clearly not understanding the background of what she's even being involved in, kind of irritates me.
The only thing that I cared about with Iron Fist was that he had good whoever they cast has good chemistry with the guy playing Luke Cage, was Mike Holder, because they're known as one of the most well-known like bromance type Marvel right. duos. Like,
yeah,
best
they're
friends
very. A lot of people loved that when they put. I mean, that's what saved it. If you look through Iron Fist history, as far as publication history goes, Iron Fist was going to be canceled and probably disappear forever. And then they paired him with Power Man in the Power Man and Iron Fist series, and it saved Iron Fist by pairing him with another minority character in. A franchise that wasn't doing so well at the time, they became a very popular duo and they played off each other really well. And yeah, they should have a good chemistry when they come together finally as the Defenders.
Yeah, I was personally pulling for Iko Uwais of the Raid fame because I know him to be an amazing fight choreographer. It's why the only anybody cares about the Raid films is because the fight scenes are some of the best that have been movies in the last decade. Now, I hope Iko Uwais is involved. He's involved with the Star Wars franchise. He helped do the fight choreography for the lightsaber fights in the Force
Awakens.
Oh,
yeah, yeah.
So he will likely be in, and those are, in my opinion, the best lightsaber fights in all the movies. They're just really well done. I imagine he'll be involved, or at least somebody will be involved from that group of people that did the Raid with Gareth Evans, who's the director of the Raid films. Anybody, they'll be involved with this, because it just seems to make sense. They're already in the Disney family. You might as well use them. Yeah. Because they do need. I mean, he's going to be. It's presumably part of it's going to take place in Asia. Presumably, at least maybe
they'd have to do some sort of origin. I would.
Because that woman, if you remember from the first season of Daredevil, there's that woman who's the drug dealer. I forget her name. She basically ran one of the most awful drug dealing operations ever. She blinds the people and has them be blind. No one pays mind to blind Walker, so she ends up being.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah, the carriers were all blind, so that nobody would.
No one mess with them. That's evil genius right there.
That is.
And she decided to leave to go to her home country or whatever. It's probably the island, and it made a lot of hints to some island from Iron Fist comics. I can never remember the name of it, but she will probably be in it. She might be in it as something involved with the main villain, whatever main villain they go with. But what we do know is that Luke Cage and Iron Fist will be in the Luke Cage show as a guest role, kind of like how Luke Cage was in Jessica Jones show,
and then spring off from that, hopefully, into something.
Yeah, because that's how we first knew the role was cast. Mike Coulter, I believe that's his name, who's playing Luke Cage, tweeted out that Iron Fist has been cast and he will be in the Luke Cage show, and he's awesome. So nice. Clearly, they have good chemistry. So that's really, really important. No. Really important.
So that, and I guess I didn't let you go into that too much, Jasyn. But do you read comics? Are you Marvel guy, DC guy? Where do you fall?
I have friends who are very, very into comics, and I tend to pick up whatever plot arc or whatever event series is really, really good. So I don't read Batman regularly, but of course I have The Dark Knight Returns and Batman Year One and That's Batman cool. The Long Halloween, because these are the landmark issues. Kingdom Come.
The Killing Joke?
I have read The Killing Joke, yeah. I'm currently reading, The Dark Knight 3, The Master Race. I thought The Dark Knight 2 was just so painfully, awfully bad.
Oh, yeah.
Is that the one they brought Jason Todd back for?
No, that's the one with where they, into the Dark Knight universe, they brought the rest of the Justice League, and Carrie Kelly, instead of being Robin, they made her Catwoman, only the costume they gave her looks like Chester Cheetah.
Oh, no.
So, like, that one... Oh, wait, isn't there a Wonder Woman villain who dresses like a leopard? Wonder Woman villain that dresses like a leopard, like the Tigress or something? I don't know.
There's a B-list Marvel Avenger named Tigress her mutation or saw her power.
I remember it from the Super Friends television show.
Yeah, the Dark Knight Strikes Back was terrible, but the Dark Knight 3, which is the Master Race, is actually turning out to be really good so far. I'm curious as to where they're going to go.
Cheetah, that's her name, Cheetah.
So more of DC, but picking up whatever's interesting.
Yeah. No, I do the same thing on the Marvel side, too. I'm actually more of an X-Men fan out of the Marvel universe.
Nice, good, good.
So the Mutant Massacre was my first big X-Men... my first big foray
massacre?
Into X-Men.
Massacre?
Where they killed all the Morlocks. They had issues of Thor that tied into it, an issue of Daredevil that tied into it, as well as the New Mutants and the X-Men and so on and so forth. It's a great series. And then, of course, you know, I've got The Age of Apocalypse. I really loved that.
Oh, yeah, that was good.
So I read a lot of the New Mutants, at least the ones that revolved around when Betsy Braddock joined the group.
Uh-huh. So that's some good classic era stuff.
Yeah. Chris Claremont was my gateway into X-Men, into all that era. So
he's a very good writer.
Magneto was a good guy at that point. It was the headmaster of the school because Professor X had disappeared. So yeah.
Right, yeah.
So I'm not a regular comics reader, and even if I was, the last year would have killed off any of my desire to continue reading anything Marvel.
It's been rough. It's been hit or miss. The benefit I've had with Marvel is that the titles and the teams that work on the titles seem to all exist in their own little universes. So while some stuff tends to bleed over from one group to another, for the most part, it's easy to focus on a handful of books and kind of ignore the rest, because you don't have to read, you know, I don't have to read Thor to be able to read X-Men. So I can ignore the garbage that they're doing with Thor to still read X-Men. It doesn't really bleed over into it all that often. So that's good.
The movies are still the best avenue for watching superheroes.
Especially the Netflix series that we're talking about. I think right now that as far as just straight up good, lengthy Marvel experience, the Netflix shows have been killing it.
They manage because they take place in the MCU, but they don't hook up with them in any way. Right. They kind of have small nods to them, like the fight that Murdoch, that his father died in, was against Creel, Crusher Creel, who became the Absorbing Man, who then showed up in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah.
In one of the only good villains that show has ever had, who they then killed off in like two episodes, because they keep doing that, and that show. That's one of the shows I gave up on. I gave up on Supergirl too.
Yeah, yeah. We finally stopped caring too much about Supergirl. So much.
I'll probably watch
wasted.
The Flash crossover though, because I
heard
love the
that
Flash.
Was good. I heard they did a good job with that.
So. That already happened.
Well, maybe not. I don't watch either one anymore, so I don't know.
No, the Flash and Arrow and Legends of Tomorrow are all really, really good. They're not Netflix series level good. But yeah. They're a week-to-week show. They're not a binge all 13 hours in an afternoon kind of show. They're one of those good shows that's good to watch week to week.
Yeah. Mm. I did want to give some time, too, since we've kind of talked about that, and we'll get into the last topic here in a minute. But I did want to talk to you, Jasyn, about, I mean, what I know you do Geek Gab. Is there any other projects you've got going on right now?
Several of them that I have to work on in turn. I work on one long enough to get it, you know, to push it forward until I can't go any further, and then I have to hit pause on that and go work on something else.
I know how that is, yeah.
I have become loath to talk about them because every time it seems like I have made a critical breakthrough and it's ready to, you know, tie it all up, finish it off, and take it public, it turns out that there's more work I need to do.
I know how that is.
I've stopped trying to make promises, because every time I make a promise to someone, or even just it's looking pretty good, I might be able to get something out in the next week or two, it turns out no, that's not happening. But I'm writing my own pen and paper tabletop role-playing game.
Oh, nice.
And I am rewriting a classic role-playing setting for use with the mechanics. I don't know if you've ever heard of the game Torg. I'm a big Torg fan, have been for a long time. I'm rewriting basically the entire Torg universe. Not to rewrite everything brand new from scratch, totally new cosmos, but just revise all the cosmos until they're a lot better than they used to be. And it's not something that's ever going to make me money, because they're coming out with a second edition of Torg sometime the next year or two. It's currently in development and playtesting. You know, this is just going to be my stuff for my game, but I think it's absolutely excellent, and the more work I put into it, the better it gets, so awesome. I'm really excited about it.
Very cool. Yeah, definitely keep us apprised of that, because I'm big into tabletop, and anything new or interesting, definitely looking forward to talking about it. And the other thing is, too, I don't know if you went into it too much, because, of course, my Twitter feed is constantly packed full and moving at the speed of light, but you recently kind of stepped back from that. Is there a huge reason why, or is it a real simple reason why, or is it something you don't want to talk about?
I just have too much stuff going on in my private life to spend any time on Twitter. Yesterday, I finally hooked up my Twitter account to my Facebook account, which means anything that gets posted on Facebook just gets automatically posted to Twitter. And so people are thinking, oh, you're back. I'm like, no, I'm not back on Twitter. I'm not going to be answering questions or anything. It's just, okay. You know, if it goes up on Facebook, it'll get reposted on Twitter. And people are like, oh, some of these links are broken. Well, you know what? That's Facebook. I can't fix that. Sorry.
Yeah, that happened. I see that a lot with Facebook posts on Twitter, is they wind up going nowhere.
I honestly think it's the privacy settings that some people, by default, anything you post on Facebook only goes to friends and friends of friends. Mm-hmm. And so if I link them to something on Facebook and they're either not logged in or they're not a friend of a friend, they won't see it. So
yeah, I like Twitter significantly more than Facebook. Facebook has become the social network for people with grandchildren, for the most part. At this point, yeah.
I have a 17-year-old, so
I'm just saying that's what it's become, because a lot of people, they share baby pictures. It seems to be what my parents use them heavily, because I've got older siblings and they have kids, and it just, you know, it's what they use it for these days. Right. And I have no problem with that. It's just I only check Facebook every so often to see if pictures that haven't been iMessaged to me are on Facebook.
I use them for two different reasons. If I follow you on Facebook, it means I really give a shit. I mean, not that I don't give a crap about people on Twitter, I really do, but my Facebook is my personal, like, I have family and coworkers and friends that I've had for 20 years on Facebook, and those are the only people I have on Facebook. Twitter, I follow everybody who follows me, and I talk to everybody who talks to me, because that, to me, that's what Twitter's for. It's easy. I don't have that much information on Twitter. Like Facebook, my address is probably on Facebook, and my phone number is probably there too.
I use Twitter for crowdsourced information. I follow 2,000 some people.
Right. So, if I follow you on Facebook, it means I consider you a much closer friend, and it's just a personal thing. That's my parents are on there, and, you know, my brother's on there, and my niece and all them. So that's what that's for, and Twitter's for the more lighthearted kind of communication between people I know. The last topic we were going to get into is you wanted to talk a little bit about, you're excited about the Pokemon releases, Russell.
There's really not a lot to talk about, but it's the next Generation 7 has been announced and will come out this holiday season, Sun and Moon. Mm-hmm. I think we know one Pokemon name, whose name I don't even know yet. We know only what it looks like, and I think its name in Japanese. We don't know anything else about it, and we probably won't know anything about it until E3, whenever that is. I'll know when it's on Twitter, basically, because I never go to E3, because unless you're a media personality, getting to E3 is probably insanely expensive.
Absolutely is. But so, I mean, people seem to be excited about, I work with a couple guys who are big Pokemon fans, and I know they're pretty excited about it.
Pokemon is one of my favorite franchises, other than Zelda. Zelda and Pokemon are pretty much the only series I buy on the day they come out, and they're generally very good to the fans. Pokemon has been, they basically decided to take the RPG style of turn-based combat, make it simpler, and then it exploded. Yeah. It is the most popular RPG series for a good reason. It's simple and easy to understand, and they don't tweak with the basic formula very much. But adding new elements and making it better every generation and every generation it comes in. I mean, X and Y, beautiful 3D, fully realized 3D environments instead of just, you know, the top-down perspective from the previous games. And that's such a good leap forward for them, especially after Generation 5 wasn't that great. Some of the Pokemon certainly were. The ideas were certainly there. It's just not one of my least favorite generations. I still love all the games. Well, hopefully you like less than others.
Yeah, hopefully it turns out good for everybody, because I know there's been some lackluster response to some of the Nintendo releases recently. So,
well, yeah, Fire Emblem is I believe far more popular in Japan than it is in the United States.
Yeah.
And this new localization problem will not help that at all.
Though, hopefully we'll have an article coming out soon about that. I mean, that's. Sure, people got upset about the localization, but a lot of the people who were upset still bought the game. I don't know if it was record shipped units or record sales, but still record
for the franchise.
And when you tell a company, at the end of the day, a company cares about one thing. And some
sales.
Companies, yeah, they care about money. And some companies understand that good customer service means more money. But at the end of the day, a company the size of Nintendo can afford to piss off a few people who still buy their game anyway, and they don't care.
It's like the people who got angry that Transformers 4 was terrible when it was the highest grossing worldwide movie of the year it came out.
Still made money, and they're going to make another one.
It may not have been the highest grossing movie in America that year, but worldwide box office made it the highest grossing movie worldwide. It made, I believe, $1.4 billion the year it came out.
So,
the studio has no reason to change course if it makes that much money. They don't have to care. They're just going to make the same. They're going to keep that formula going. Yes, people who grew up on Transformers in the cartoons didn't like the movies. I never grew up with that because I didn't grow up in the 80s. So I only understood it from the toys and the Beast Wars show from the early 90s and the new Transformers show from the early 2000s that I personally did enjoy at least the first season of before it kind of really got weird.
I enjoyed them. I didn't enjoy the last couple, but when all I needed to hear, and Jasyn, you may be with me on this, but when I heard Peter Cullen speak for the first time out of what looked like a real Optimus Prime, that pulled me in. I forgave that first movie so much when Optimus Prime talked and it was Peter Cullen. Like, that was such a moment.
The fourth one had I've only seen the first and fourth one from start to finish. I never saw I saw parts of the second one. I don't think I saw any parts of the third one. The biggest issue with the Transformers franchise is that they're just popcorn movies. They're not intended to be taken seriously, and they're not good. What I liked about the fourth one more than the first one is that there were significantly less Transformers, and they all had distinct personalities. You might not have liked those personalities, or for what have you, for whatever reasons, but they at least had significantly more distinct personalities.
So I'm just guessing, Jasyn. We're probably about in the same age group. Did you grow up as well with those classic cartoons?
I watched the Transformers when I was a kid. Yeah, I liked them. I liked most of the movies. First one was good. The second one was terrible. It was just a big, massive disappointment. Yeah. The third one was really, really enjoyable. Not as good as the first, but enjoyable.
Right.
And I think the fourth one took a dip in quality, but it wasn't as. It still wasn't as bad as the second, so...
Here's the thing about the second one.
We all forgot the Decepticons have the ability to make human-sized, convincing robots. Everyone kind of forgot about that after that scene happened, when he was being seduced by the Decepticon. No one seemed to remember that. That if they have the ability to do that, they could take over the human race in, like, a week.
Yeah.
Just all make them all hot ladies. And half the population will be enslaved in a week.
Just give it up. Just be done, because that's all we need. I guess that pretty much exhausts that. And I did want to cover one last thing, and I don't want to get too deeply into it, because we don't know a whole lot right now. And I have to preface this because I'm gonna put on my journalism hat for a minute. We've been talking more low-key, lighthearted news, but I did reach out to Nintendo. Nintendo of America, after we saw some of the stuff that came out about one of their PR reps, Allison Rapp, and I asked them. My email basically said I've been a lifelong fan of Nintendo. Up until the last few years, I've bought Nintendo consoles exclusively. I've had a Nintendo since the 8-bit system came out, and as a father, and a Nintendo fan, I just wanted to know what their response was. What did they think about the things that were being said and revealed about this person that works on their PR firm? And I haven't heard back yet. So that's my disclosure. I did reach out to Nintendo for a response. I can't reach out to Allison Rapp all that well because she has me blocked on Twitter. So, and I've never talked to her before. So she's one of those people that's clearly afraid. Yeah, either on a block list or clearly afraid of anybody who has an opposing opinion. But I guess my stance on this, and hopefully you guys are both abreast of what's going on, but the thesis thing, we have to take that with a grain of salt, so to speak, because we all know if you've been to college or you went to any kind of advanced writing courses in high school, and my son had to do this too, oftentimes you're given papers that you have to write where you have to defend something you don't agree with. This last semester, I believe my son and a friend had to have a debate where one of them had to defend slavery and the other person had to be a detractor. So it teaches you, defending the indefensible teaches you how people can do that, how people could justify certain things in their head. So it's not beyond reason that this thesis that she wrote saying that child pornography laws are too strict is one of those things. It may not be. But it's possible that it was. Where it became an issue for me is after that, she defended that paper and she continued to defend the stance that child pornography laws are too strict and that they need to be lessened. And then under the PR header, and this is where things get sketchy. She on Twitter says she works for Nintendo. We know she's PR. Her literal job is to not be a douchebag. Like, that's her job. Her job is not an accountant. She's not a developer. She's not a mailroom person. Her job is to be the face of Nintendo to the public and not be a jerk. And she was a jerk. And she defended her stances under the header of a Nintendo employee. Now, if I were to wear my company's logo on a shirt and go out in public and be a dick to a bunch of people, those people would have every right to call my employer and say, hey, you got a guy wearing your company logo out here at Walmart, you know, kicking people around and being an asshole. And my company would have every right to say, hey, that doesn't represent our company. And we're going to take disciplinary action. So everybody that's screaming about censorship and free speech and blah, certain things have to be common sense. Like, just because, yeah, she has the right to say whatever she wants, but the company she works for also has the right to protect their brand and to deal with customers the way they're supposed to deal with customers. And it's her job. She's a PR person. If she was a backroom accountant, nobody would be talking about this. She is the face of Nintendo
in this
particular sphere. Yeah, if she was running her own company, then people would just be saying, hey, I'm not going to buy your product because you, as the owner of this company, I don't like you.
She's trying to use the excuse that she's being attacked like Zoe and Anita were, but Zoe and Anita were both bosses of their own company, essentially. She is not.
Right.
She has to answer to somebody above her. They didn't have to. And as much as I don't like those figures, they're allowed to do what they want. They have fans that will support them on Patreon and give them enough money to basically pay all their monthly bills without having to do anything. I don't have a problem with that. It's America. Go what you want with the free market. People want to give you money, I'm not going to stop you. But she works for a company that does care about its image, and she's in PR. So if this gets any bigger coverage, like if other people start talking about it, or they circle the wagons, it'll all be interesting to see if Nintendo addresses this. If Nintendo addresses this. Because honestly, I don't think it's going to lead to her getting fired at all, but I didn't even know her name until this happened. So it's not like... It's not like anyone cares. No one will care about her in a year. She'll be even if whether she's working Nintendo or not, her name will be forgotten.
Yeah,
this is what's going to happen.
Jasyn, have you seen much about that? Commented much about it?
I've heard about it. Yeah, she seems to be very, very arrogant, very, very smug, and I can't believe that someone would. But then again, I'm always appalled by how smug sometimes these the SJWs act. You want to sit there and you know, kind of just talk to them like a normal person and say, don't you realize that's a dumb thing that that right. doesn't help your case. You look like an asshole yeah. when you do that. Don't you think you ought to be just a touch bit more polite to people?
Especially when you're a PR person, like for a yeah. family entertainment company. I mean, no bones about it. Nintendo is, if any video game is for children, they're Nintendo games. Almost every parent knows that they can count on Nintendo games. You can go out and buy any Mario game and give it to your kids, and you know it's going to be appropriate for them.
Oh, it looks like a big name person released somebody bigger than either of us. Contacted Nintendo's supervisory line. And got saying they will actually do so, they will contact her. So there may be a resolution to this storyline in the next couple of days.
And, you know, honestly, at the end of the day, all I was interested in was hearing a Nintendo say, we will address it with our employee and we will handle it internally, which is that's all. It doesn't need to be a witch burn. It doesn't need to be some public spectacle. Talk to her, write her up. I mean, I work at a big, not a huge company, but I work at a big company, and you have rules, you have the ways you have to handle things. And yeah, not everything people say publicly should be held against them where they work. But when you're the public face of your company, or when you do things under the header of your company, like if you send out a shitty letter under your company's letterhead, that's the same thing. It's essentially sending out a letter on your company's letterhead, except you did it on Twitter, because at the top of your Twitter profile it says I work for Nintendo, and yeah. then you say something douchey under that. I mean, that common sense, people, you know. But I would like to I don't want an apology. I would obviously that's silly to expect that, but for her to at least say, yeah, I mean, even if she just said, yeah, those are things, I wrote that college paper when I was young, I had to defend a stance that was unpopular, okay, maybe I had some weird opinions, or that's just my opinion, and it's not, I try not to translate that into work, and I will do better in the future. I'll set like a response other than screw you guys, I'll say what I want, because that's not a PR person, you know, and that's basically what she's doing right now.
Yeah, the Cartman response to it is not a wise response.
Mm-mm. No, from an average person on their personal Twitter who isn't associated with anything PR or HR or public, you know, related. Sure, I'll say that all day long, but I'm just me. You know, I don't have my company's name in my profile except for my website, and I represent my website. If you don't want to come to my website because you don't like me, don't come to my website because you don't like me and tell me about it. And if I agree with you, maybe I'll say, yeah, I shouldn't have said that. But, you know, you don't, yeah, you're right. You don't just say, screw you guys, I'll do whatever I want. Not when that's what's in your Twitter feed. Not when you represent a company like that.
Yeah, and this is the biggest. Here I said the biggest issue here is how many people actually care about this. Right. And if it looks, as I said, if it gets to a fever pitch, if somebody like huge in the game, for instance, if I don't know somebody like Total Biscuit or PewDiePie or any of the big figures in YouTube, because seriously, that's where all the money is these days. That's where all the video game companies are spending their PR, their marketing right. budget. I mean, Far Cry Primal isn't sending out review copies. They've been sponsoring YouTube videos for the last week and a half. So yeah, if one of them gets on it, like Bogey or Total Biscuit does a video on it, maybe Nintendo will respond. But if they don't, Nintendo may be. If they do respond, it'll be very hush-hush. It won't make a lot of waves. Maybe our circles will see it, but it won't approach the broader gamer subcategory.
Right, and it doesn't need to be. It doesn't need to be a win. That's not what this is about at all, for me anyway. It's not about winning something or losing something or making a statement even. It's literally, I want to buy a Nintendo. I'm looking at a Wii U, hopefully this winter, when the prices come down again, because I don't have a boatload of money to just throw away. And I want to feel good about buying this game system, that there's a possibility. I mean, God forbid my son have a child this young, but it could happen. I could have a grandchild playing a Wii U, and I want to be comfortable in the knowledge that this family gaming company has sold me a product without that
get him
baggage.
Get him a 3DS. Get your grandchild a 3DS.
Yeah.
By the time
it'll be mine. I'm buying a Wii U for me.
I'm just saying, by the time that grandchild's old enough to hold a controller, first of all, the 3DS might, I mean, we'll probably be in the next console generation, because it's like three or more years. I mean, how early are you going to start a kid on video gaming?
My kid was three when he started.
There you go. So think about it. At most, you're thinking of you're three years and 9 months away from possibly having, at the earliest, having a grandchild play.
Right.
By then, the Wii U will not be the prime. We'll be in the next console generation.
But so I'll be Wii old U. by then, and I won't be buying all the new stuff anyway.
Well, yeah, so. I would. I'm probably gonna buy the next Nintendo console, assuming they do what they did with the Wii and launch with a Zelda title, because it seems what they're doing. They keep pushing the new Zelda that was supposed to come out for the Wii U. And they keep doing it, so it's probably going to happen where they'll release it on the new system at launch and then release it for the Wii U as the last game that'll ever come out for it, like a month or two later, like they did with. Because, in my opinion, GameCube is my favorite console ever. It's the one I have the most games for. It's the one I enjoy the most. But, yeah, they was very smart to launch with a Zelda title. It definitely juiced Wii sales. Guarantee it juiced the Wii sales. So they'll probably do that, the NX or whatever they're going to call it.
Yeah.
And that's probably what they're going to launch at E3. E3 is probably going to be spent a lot on premiering their new console. I guarantee. If they don't, they're foolish. Because they'll win. They'll win E3 if they debut footage of their new console. Immediately win. Because there's not going to be a PS5 anytime soon, and Xbox 2 won't be coming out anytime soon, or whatever they name the next one. I have no idea why they called their third console Xbox One.
Still don't get that. We've hit almost an hour, and this is, like as we talked earlier, this is kind of a light news show. It was a light news week.
Yeah, because nothing happened. Yeah, very little happened the last week.
So, Jasyn, how often can people catch Geek Gab on your YouTube channel?
We're roughly once a week, a little bit less, just depending.
Okay. And, I'll definitely link to that. I think I still have to subscribe. I don't remember if I have or not, but I'll make sure I get over there and do that.
If you want a quick link, is.gd/geekgab will take you right to the YouTube page.
is.gd/geekgab. Geekgab. If you didn't get that, I will be putting a link in my YouTube video when it goes up, hopefully by the weekend, because I'm going to have to grab what we did feed and pair it together with this. So sorry, everybody that watched, you missed some of this. Hopefully I'll have it up by the weekend.
It's clear. Clearly, I think your computer might just gotten overextended.
Something. Well, and it's a new system, so that's what concerns me. There's some little quirky setting I need to fix, because this is everything in here except for the memory is brand new. So
it happened. It happened within 5 minutes of coming back. I don't know.
Yeah, that. So it's different than the last time. The last technical difficulties we had happened about 45 minutes in, and I had a really loud tone in my headset, which I didn't have this time. So it's not the sound card. I fixed that issue. So hopefully we'll get the next one fixed, but I'll do some testing over the next few days and some hidden streams. So you guys might stop by the live page and see me testing stuff. I don't know. I'm going to try to get this sorted out before the next show. But thank you, guys. Thank you, Jasyn, for joining us. Hopefully we can have you back in the future.
Yeah. And hopefully there's more news by next Tuesday.
Yeah.
It was so light. The only big thing that happened, like the only huge thing that happened last week, was Iron Fist being cast. It's the only thing that really was huge.
Just
like the Oscars
much.
Happened and they were nothing. Burger. And the Pokemon thing that they said, they're going to have a Nintendo event about Pokemon on Friday. And it was all big Nintendo event. It ended up being 6 minutes long. There was no gameplay footage. There was nothing.
Yep. So we will we'll say goodnight to anybody watching. We'll have Jasyn back in the future, and Russell will always be back, and thank you very much.